Have you ever wondered why it takes longer to fly from one place to another than it did decades ago? Consider this. While the average car's top speed has increased by nearly 30% over the past 50 years, and modern high-speed trains like the TGV in France or the Shinkansen in Japan can travel at speeds surpassing 300 kilometers per hour, commercial air travel speeds have largely remained static. In 1970, the Boeing 747 cruised at around 570 miles per hour. Not significantly different from the 560 miles per hour average of today's popular Boeing 777. Moreover, the Eurostar, connecting London to Paris, has reduced its travel time by nearly 20 minutes since its inception in 1994, and electric cars are continually pushing the boundaries of speed, with some now capable of 0 to 60 miles per hour in under 2 seconds. Yet, the curious fact remains, a flight from London to New York, which historically has taken just under 7 hours, now frequently inches closer to the 8-hour mark. Why, in an era where ground transportation is continuously breaking its own records, has the aviation industry not seen a similar leap in speed? In a world where technology perpetually advances, this deceleration in commercial flight speeds is a perplexing anomaly. There's a plethora of variables that play into flight times, many of which are obscured by the intricacies of the aviation world. The late 20th century was an exciting era for aviation. With the Cold War in full swing, there was intense competition between nations to push the boundaries of what was achievable in the air. This competitive spirit extended to commercial aviation as well. Airlines were not just selling tickets, they were selling experiences, and speed was a massive part of that allure. The Concorde, the supersonic passenger jet operated by British Airways and Air France, became the pinnacle of this speed obsession. With its sleek nose and delta wings, it wasn't just a mode of transport, but an emblem of a futuristic vision, cutting transatlantic flight times in half. However, the Concorde was not alone. Various aircraft of that era, like the Soviet Tupolev Tu-144 and an American Douglas DC-8, were designed with speed in mind. The idea was simple. Faster planes meant quicker trips, and quicker trips were the ultimate selling point. But as time progressed, the priorities of the aviation industry began to shift. Several intertwined reasons played pivotal roles in this transition, and the first is fuel efficiency. The global oil crises of the 1970s brought a harsh reality to the forefront. Speed burns fuel, and fuel was becoming expensive. A 10% reduction in cruise speed, for instance, could lead to a 20% fuel saving, translating to millions of dollars saved for airlines annually. Boeing's 787 Dreamliner serves as a compelling example in the evolution of aircraft design for fuel efficiency. Using advanced materials like carbon fiber reinforced polymer, the Dreamliner boasts about a 20% improvement in fuel economy over older models of similar passenger capacity. An academic study by the Massachusetts Institute of Technology illuminated that drag, a resistance force against the plane's forward motion, increases exponentially with speed. So, a minor uptick in speed can result in a significantly higher fuel burn rate. The Concorde, despite its engineering marvel, had its inefficiencies. It consumed about 6.7 times more fuel per passenger compared to a Boeing 747 on similar long-haul routes. Furthermore, its supersonic speed led to sonic booms, causing disturbances below its flight path. Beyond design, operational tactics play a role, which brings us to the environmental concerns. It wasn't just about money. Faster planes, especially those breaching the sound barrier, resulted in sonic booms, causing noise pollution. As urban areas around airports grew, so did the complaints about aircraft noise. Regulations became tighter, forcing manufacturers to design quieter and often slower engines. Moreover, the emissions from these speed giants were considerably higher. As the world became more environmentally conscious, these concerns began to outweigh the benefits of rapid transit. Today's aviation landscape is almost unrecognizable compared to the golden age of speed. Air traffic has exploded, with over 4 billion passengers flying annually by the early 2020s. With the skies busier than ever, safety became paramount. The vast network of planes in the air at any given moment necessitated a controlled, systematic approach. As a result, air traffic control had to manage not just the speed of individual planes, but the flow of traffic. Sometimes this meant planes had to fly slower or take longer routes to avoid congestion, ensuring that the skies remained safe. One of the main issues with modern air travel is congestion. There's been a significant jump in the number of people flying, especially in rapidly growing countries like China and India. Data from the International Air Transport Association shows that 4.4 billion people flew in 2018, and they expect this number to rise to 8.2 billion by 2037. Because of this increased demand, our skies and airports are becoming very busy. A practical example of this is Beijing Capital International Airport. It was so crowded that Beijing opened another major airport in 2019, the Daxing International Airport. But even with two airports, it's estimated that by 2025, they will handle over 170 million passengers every year combined. This busyness can mean longer waits for planes, both in the air and on the ground. Airports like London's Heathrow, which is one of the world's busiest, frequently have planes waiting because they have just two runways. This congestion can be expensive, with delays at Heathrow in 2019 costing airlines around $1.5 billion. Another reason why planes are slower today is because airlines pad their schedules with extra time to account for inevitable delays. This is a common practice in the industry, and it has several benefits for both airlines and passengers. First of all, schedule padding helps airlines improve their on-time performance ratings. According to the U.S. Department of Transportation, in 2019, about 79% of flights were on time. Improving this metric is crucial for customer satisfaction and reputation. By adding extra time to their flights, airlines can avoid being penalized for late arrivals or departures, which can affect their rankings and potential fines by regulatory bodies. Secondly, schedule padding benefits travelers. A study by the Bureau of Transportation Statistics found that in the U.S., approximately 1.9% of all scheduled flights in 2019 were canceled. Schedule padding can aid in reducing this number and help passengers avoid missing their connections or important appointments due to flight delays. The exact amount of extra time airlines add to their flights varies. According to the Telegraph, some flights can have up to an hour of extra time added to their schedules. A comparative look shows that a flight from London Heathrow to New York, JFK, took about 7 hours and 15 minutes. In 1996. In contrast, the same journey stretched to 8 hours and 15 minutes by 2019. While it might seem counterintuitive, this doesn't necessarily mean that planes are flying slower. They might just be allocated more time to account for uncertainties. In certain situations, with favorable conditions like tailwinds or clear skies, planes can even reach their destination faster than the padded schedule. The slowdown in commercial aviation speed isn't indicative of technological stagnation. On the contrary, we have planes today that can fly incredibly fast. Military jets like the Lockheed SR-71 Blackbird could reach speeds of Mach 3.3 faster than any commercial plane. But here's the thing, speed for the sake of speed isn't always efficient or economical. Even if we have the technology to fly faster, it doesn't mean it's the most practical choice for passenger air travel. Take the Concorde, for example. Yes, it was fast, but it was also notoriously expensive to operate and maintain. Ticket prices were prohibitively high for the average traveler, and its sonic boom limited its routes. A significant shift in the aviation landscape was the rise of budget airlines. By the 2000s, carriers such as Ryanair, Southwest, and EasyJet had disrupted the industry with their no-frills, cost-effective approach. For these airlines, turning a profit wasn't about how fast they could get passengers to their destinations, but how efficiently they could operate. Every decision, from the type of planes they purchased to the speed at which they flew, was driven by cost considerations. Given that fuel expenses account for a significant chunk of operational costs, flying faster and thereby consuming more fuel was antithetical to the low-cost model. This emphasis on cost over speed trickled down, influencing even the more prominent legacy carriers as they tried to compete in an increasingly cost-conscious market. While it might seem counterintuitive, modern planes are marvels of engineering, not because they fly faster, but because they are designed to meet a diverse set of demands. Today's aircraft are quieter, more fuel efficient, and have longer ranges than many of their predecessors. Take the Boeing 787 Dreamliner or the Airbus A350, for instance. While they might not be breaking any speed records, they can fly incredibly long routes without stopping. Think flights from Singapore to New York or London to Perth. This ability to fly long-haul routes directly, even if slightly slower, can still get passengers to their destinations faster than a speedier plane that needs to stop for refueling. Furthermore, these modern planes are built with advanced materials that make them lighter and more aerodynamic. They also incorporate sophisticated technology to ensure smoother rides, reducing the impact of turbulence. All these innovations prioritize passenger comfort and operational efficiency over sheer speed. Looking forward, the dilemma between speed and sustainability becomes even more pronounced. As the global conversation pivots towards environmental conservation, the aviation industry is under increasing pressure to reduce its carbon footprint. While there are experimental ventures aiming to bring back supersonic travel, like this American company, Boom Supersonic, they face significant challenges. Not only do they need to address the environmental concerns that plague their predecessors, but they also need to do so in an industry that's more competitive and cost-sensitive than ever. Concurrently, there's a push towards more eco-friendly modes of transport. Electric planes and hydrogen fuel cell technology are in the developmental stages, promising cleaner alternatives to the fossil fuel-guzzling jets of today. However, these technologies currently come with limitations, including reduced speeds compared to conventional aircraft. The story of speed in aviation is a tale as old as the industry itself. While the early days were marked by a fervent race to fly faster, the complexities of economics, technology, and environmental concerns have since reshaped priorities. Today's aircraft, although slower than some of their iconic predecessors, reflect a nuanced understanding of what passengers and the planet need. Sometimes progress doesn't always mean moving faster, it's about moving smarter. As we stand on the precipice of a new era in aviation with challenges like climate change looming large, the industry's direction will be dictated not just by how fast we can go, but by how thoughtfully we can navigate the skies. And in that journey, perhaps the tortoise's approach, slow, steady, and sustainable, might just win the race. Well, thanks for watching. This episode is brought to you with the help of these Patreon supporters and YouTube subscribers who have joined. Thanks to everyone who is supporting. Thanks for watching. More interesting videos are coming up. Don't forget to subscribe and hit the like button.